This week on the Unpopular Opinion Show.
A pink training bra and a purple fur coat.
I just can't take his anger seriously. He's like,
either pay me or I'll take it.
Every child growing up in a home without the father in it is going to turn out to be a stripper.
That was weird. It was out of bounds. And you know what I'm saying?
I am pleased to know that at 50, she still has good.
Some of these sisters got city miles, brother.
We are trying to on your Christmas.
I think you need to say clearly what happened.
Who gives a fuck?
I don't care if you personally hit Candace Owens and her stanky
cray cray.
No good thing starts with, I was thinking about my ex.
He ain't learned his lesson. That's a brother ain't gonna learn shit.
I know this is gonna be about you, and I don't care.
Let's keep this shit funky.
Yes, yes, y'all. What's happening? What's happening? What's cracking? Happy holidays to you all. Welcome to another episode of the Unpopular Opinion Show. I go by the name of T-Storm and joined by my brother, as always, the one and only DJ Mike Swift. What's up, brother?
What's happening, man? Somebody decided to call me right when the show started, right? So while you're talking, the phone rings in the background. We trying to be classy, not ghetto.
Right, right. No, I mean, it's classetto. I don't know. Is that a word? Can we make it?
Maybe it's just ghetto ass.
Ghetto ass. Oh, man. How was your week?
My week was decent until Tuesday.
Okay.
So I stepped on the scale last week. I'm 7 pounds away from 200 pounds. I'm a short dude, right? So I'm like, I got to do something. I got to lose some of this weight. So I said, okay, on Monday, I'm going to start doing smoothies again for breakfast instead of doing hash browns and salmon croquettes and toast and grits and all that shit I used to eat.
Right, right.
So Monday went fine. Tuesday, I'm standing in the kitchen. I'm with my blender. I'm making my smoothie. I turned to reach to get something out of the refrigerator, and my back went. So I've been in excruciating pain all week. It's a lot better now, but it still hurts. But I don't know what the hell happened. But my back was killing me.
Damn. Okay.
Yeah.
That does not sound fun. I deal with back issues already, so I empathize. Like, golly. Your back and your feet, and they're both connected, can throw you completely off. If your feet, and people that know this, if your feet hurt, that'll ruin your entire week. Your week is like from one day of your feet hurt, you just throw you completely off. And if your back tighten up, forget it. That's about a month. So
I was popping ibuprofen like Tic Tacs.
I finally bought a new mattress about a month ago and been able to sleep better. I guess I don't realize that the mattress, you know, it's time to get a new one. Or, you know, my wife was complaining, you know, waking up stiff and everything. And I already have back issues, so I just figured it was just a regular thing. And right. She was like, we got to get a new mattress. I was like, all right, fine. So I order a mattress and it comes. And almost immediately, I noticed the difference. Like, body is not, you know what I mean, as tense or tight, you know, when we get up in the morning. So it's, who knew?
Did you get one of the traditional ones or did you go like purple or one of the new foam type deals?
No, I got it's a pillow top type kind of medium firm mattress. Okay. I did it online. So it was like through faith. Like, I don't know what this is really going to feel like. Right. This is what the description says it is. All right, let's hope it is what it is. And it got here. I was like, okay, it's good. It's a little soft. It's a little softer than I thought it was going to be, but you know, but it don't, you're like, you jump on it and it don't bounce. So I'm like, all right, it works.
I'm going to have to bite that bullet in January. It's one of them things that I know I need to buy. I know I need to do. It's like, another thing, right? You think it's, I'll get to it. But yeah, it's I'm long overdue for a new mattress.
Yeah, it's the funny. Here's the funny shit about it. Here's the funny shit about it. The dynamic between my wife and I is, and I think I've said this before, but I'll say it again. And I talk, she'll probably pop up as you know. You say her name three times, she appears. But my wife is notoriously cheap, like notoriously cheap. Like there's a different frugal. She is frugal. And then notoriously cheap on top of being frugal. So it's like, it'll be, you know, trying to get her to buy a new phone. She's like, I don't need a phone. I don't need a phone. But your phone only stays on for an hour. You have to get a new phone. Your bat is dead. Like, I don't need a phone. I'm not getting a new phone. No, I'm not buying a new phone. Nope, nope, nope. You have to physically take the phone from her, buy a new phone, right? So for her to go, we need a new mattress. You know what I'm saying? Goes, all right, well. And I'm the one being like, nah, I don't think we really. No, I don't want to spend money on that right now. No, 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 no. But she was right. So,
nah, man, that's the move. Yeah, I need to do it. Shit. Yeah, man.
Sleeping a lot better. Since well, we're not going to drone on about politics today. Just so you know, I ordered a few things. One, shout out to Cool DJ Red Alert. This is his line. Product of hip hop, 1973.
Fresh.
Yeah, it's pretty dope. And he got my size. That's what's really important here. That's what's really important here. It's comfortable, it's good material, and they got my size. Like I can't do a 2X. like if that's the biggest the shirt or t-shirt or sweatshirt go, it ain't for me. And I've learned that. And then 2X is not as big as it used to be, or maybe it's just me. Whatever.
I just had this mental image of you in a goddamn 2X t-shirt looking like fucking spandex top.
a 2X, you know what a 2X t-shirt looks like on me? Remember the questionable wife beaters 50 Cent used to wear? It looked like that looked like a damn bra. That's what a 2X t-shirt looks like on me.
50s joints used to look like weird ass halter tops. Like, I was like, what the fuck is
like
that?
Like a training bra. Like, what are you doing, bro? What are you trying to say here? And then, like, Cam, I think I seen Cam with something similar in pink. Dude, that's just not even the.
Like, I don't know. A pink training bra and a purple fur coat. Talking about I'm straight.
Yeah, you know, there was the, you know, they felt rep, you know, but I'll stop the joke there. I'll stop the joke there. That's it. But yeah, number 46 hat I got from the body camp and the shirt to match and some wine glasses that are on the way as well. I'll wear that later on. In 2021, I'll rock that. You know what I mean? So I interesting things that happened this week. Where we start off with Tom Cruise, because his freak out on the set of, is it Mission Impossible? Was it 7?
Mission Impossible 95. Right. I think the world, I mean, let's just be honest. I think the world stopped giving a fuck about the Mission Impossible movies after 3. But all right, they're shooting Mission Impossible 7. Mm-hmm. And apparently on the set, some of the crew did not observe the COVID safety protocols. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Cruise had some very encouraging and well put phrases and phrasing for his team.
Check it.
You're back here in Hollywood making movies right now because of us. Because they believe in us and what we're doing.
He clearly has a mask on.
I'm on the phone with every studio at night.
Because he's doing
companies. Producers. And they're looking at us and using us to make their movies. We are creating thousands of jobs.
Yeah, point.
I don't ever want to see it again.
Okay.
Ever.
But I'm saying though.
And if you don't do it, you're fired. And I see you do it again, you're f-ing gone.
So you want me to do it or you don't want me to
Anyone
do it?
Anyone on this crew does it.
Does it or it. You see it?
And
which is it?
Do, And you too.
Me?
And you.
Damn.
You ever do it again.
All right, man.
That's it.
Okay, all right.
No apologies. You can tell it to the people that are losing their homes because our industry is shut down.
Okay, all right.
You got to put food on their table.
You got it, man. You
pay for their college education.
You're right. I'm just saying, but you know,
that's what I sleep with every night.
Okay, all right. That's can we get back to work now?
The future of the industry.
Okay.
So I'm sorry. I'm beyond your apology.
All right.
I have told you, and now I want it. And if you don't do it, you're out. We are not shutting this movie down!
Oh, goddamn. All right, good. Thank you. All right.
Is it understood? If I see it again, you're gone.
So if I see it, if you see it, or if I do it.
You're going to cost him his job. If I see it on the set, you're gone.
So if you see it.
You're gone.
Okay. All right. Don't want that to
happen. That's it.
All right. All right.
Am I clear?
Again,
you
yes.
You understand what I want. You understand the responsibility that you have.
Can you say it in Spanish?
Because I will deal with your reason. And if you can't be reasonable, I can't deal with your logic, you're fired. That's it.
What does my logic have to
that's
do with
it?
Okay. You said, all right. You said that's it three times now. Are we done?
I trust you guys to be
here. Still going. All right. Goddamn. Like he went on. Okay. So on one hand, him, you know, going off like that, I can appreciate him wanting to make sure everyone is safe, make sure that the business isn't shut down, you know, because there's a lot of people depending on it. Right. Berating grown folks like that, I have a problem with it. You know what I'm saying? I don't think it's necessary. When you yelling again, this is something I've said in my own house, and I'm not that I'm perfect. I still yell, but when you're yelling, people don't hear what you're saying. They just hear the volume at what you're saying.
Yeah, and I think I don't know if he's producing that film.
Yeah, I think he's the executive producer.
The film. He's producing it. So, yeah. Right. So he's coming at it from a much different place than, you know, everybody else, right? Mm-hmm. Everybody else is just like, well, I just got to get my check or whatever. They don't care. So I feel his passion. And I'm kind of with his delivery a little bit. My partner, we ran a business together for years and it was the nicest guy you'll ever meet. But there were, sometimes he would talk to people real sideways. Mm. And I asked him once, dude, why you do that? He was like, because some people only understand CO talk. And I was like, CO talk? He's like, correctional officer. Some God people damn. Only understand when you come at them like that. When you come at them kind and you know, rational, they take that for weakness. And they still do whatever the hell they want to do. So I kind of understand where he's coming from. I think he might have been a little bit over the top. But most importantly, Tom Cruise is 2'2" with stacks on. Like, I can't take his mad seriously. I just can't take his anger seriously. It's like, all right, motherfucker.
Seen him walking around the set in heeled shoes. Some high-heeled shoes to make him feel a little taller and still come up short is has to be. Whoever recorded did not give a fuck. This is like, okay, this. No. And he probably did it before.
Oh, I'm sure of it. That was probably why they put the recorder on when he called a meeting. It was like, let me switch this on so I can get this and make him look bad. And I don't think it's really making him look bad like that. I think everybody who hears it goes, fair enough. He makes good points.
Yeah.
He didn't say, go fuck yourself. You're keeping me from buying a yacht. He's like actually concerned about other people. So,
yeah. I'm paying attention to what he didn't say. It wasn't like, I don't need this. I'm here for y'all. He could have been like on some real dick shit.
I've been here for y'all. Motherfucker.
Yeah, I don't need this movie. You know what I'm saying? I made enough of these already.
He's like, I'm still spending Top Gun money.
So if y'all want to mess this up and get this shut down, fine, whatever, it's on you. What we'll be doing here, like, Then they, that attention would have been like, he's a dick, but okay, let's not mess this up. So, oh. But that reminds me of, well, what's the actor that was in Batman that did the same shit?
Christian Bale.
Freaking out over a, so I don't even know, it was the boom operator or whoever it was, but Family Guy did an excellent edit of it where they put Peter Griffin in the audio reacting to the shit that he was saying. Classic. So, you know.
Yeah, this was different than that. Christian Bale was just on some old, I'm an actor type shit. It's right. Like, look, motherfucker, this is a goddamn Batman movie. How seriously do you really want us to be taking this?
Right. Yeah, you think you're going to get an Oscar for this, dude? Come on, son. You know,
so my dumbass didn't hit record on nothing. So oh. So the first few minutes is,
yeah, so let's hope the digital gods be nice.
Right, God.
Yeah. What you got though?
So I thought it was interesting this week, the Dave Chappelle shit. Mm. So I don't know if everybody has seen it, and I can't even remember the name of that clip. But since,
Unforgiven.
What was the name of it?
Unforgiven.
So it's a clip on you can get it on YouTube. I think I saw it up on YouTube. Dave Chappelle, Unforgiven. And
it's
again,
on his Instagram. It's on his Instagram.
Yeah, yeah. And again, it's Dave doing Dave's style and ain't really no whole lot of jokes in there, right? It's funny, but it's not a lot of jokes in there. And right. it's live. It's in front of an audience. Since COVID started, he's been doing shows. He has not stopped really doing shows. He does them in a small town where he is. And he's on the road in Texas with Joe Rogan.
Okay.
They're doing shows out there because Rogan moved from LA to Texas. He's moved his podcast, everything, out to Texas.
Oh, wow.
So they do shows out there. But he does this bit and it's pretty short. And he talks about the whole thing of it is how Comedy Central owns outright Chappelle Show.
Mm-hmm.
He makes no money off of it. He can't use it. They own his name as it relates to that show. All that shit.
They didn't pay him when he left. That's another thing. I have some of the audio here. We can just refresh your memory here. So, I ain't gonna fuck it.
You know what? Tell you the truth. I've even thought about coming back and doing another Chappelle show. Well, but if I do, I can't call it Chappelle Show because my name and likeness is being used by them in perpetuity throughout the universe. It's in the contract.
Again, the audience don't really know how to react to this.
Yeah. It's like, is
You're
that
not
good?
Supposed to do this in my business. Mm-hmm. I'm up here doing something that nobody else in this business has the balls to do. I'm telling you something that you need to know. I'm trying to explain to you what you're seeing. You don't understand what you're seeing. I am publicly flogging a network. And I know that this network niggas, they watching me and they saying, why are you doing this so publicly? Doesn't feel good to be flogged publicly. Oh, believe me, I know. I know exactly how that feels. When I quit my show, they said I was crazy. What was crazy about it? I just didn't want to do it anymore. They said I smoked crack. That's impossible. I was a devout Muslim. I didn't smoke or drink. But I do now, bitch, because you ruined my fucking life.
He's bringing some jokes in there, but it was there was not many punchlines. But yeah, I think what notable, him talking to Comedy Central about the situation, saying, listen, either pay me or I'll take it. And, you know, he encouraged folks to, you know, because he talked about Netflix running Chappelle's show and him being upset about it and calling Netflix. And they go, hey, just to make sure you don't feel like we're doing you dirty, we'll pull it. And he encouraged folks to not to boycott HBO Max, but he said, boycott me. Don't watch Chappelle's show. And that I saw plenty of people take up, hey, boycott Chappelle. Don't watch Chappelle's show. That caught on. That clearly got their attention.
It got their attention, and they pulled it.
Yeah.
And Casey Bloys, the chief content officer of HBO and HBO Max, had a statement. She said, "We had a conversation with Dave. I won't get into it, but it's very clear that it is a very unique and specific and emotional issue he's got. So at the end of the year, December 31st, we're going to honor his request and take the show down." So good on them, right?
Yeah.
I did not like the use of emotional in her statement.
And that's what I was like.
When I read it the first time, I was like, you bitch. Right, like
little jab, little jab at Chappelle, and he's kind of pissed at HBO, and because I think at the beginning of that special he talked about that it was public knowledge that he had shopped that concept to HBO initially, and they said something to the effect of "What do we need you for?"
Yep, directly said, quoted from the special. They said, literally, what do we need you for? That's what they told me as they kicked me out of the office. What do we need you for? And here we are all these years later, and they're streaming the very show I was pitching to them. So I'm asking them, what do you need me for?
Right.
Man, if that ain't the biggest thumb in the eye.
Oh, man. Yeah, you know. So... good. They pulled it as a little backhanded, you know. He's emotional about it, but yeah, so we'll pull it. Okay. But so now what is, you know, I'm curious to know what would Viacom and Comedy Central do now?
I don't think they're gonna give him any kind of rights back. I think egos, boardroom egos, CEO egos, that kind of level. Is at play, and I think they'll just shelve it. They'll say, if we can't make money off of it, nobody's going to make money off of it. We got plenty of intellectual property that we can make money off of, so we'll put this in a vault somewhere and let it collect us. Kind of like how Birdman did Wayne's album.
Right.
Go fuck yourself and just put it on the shelf. I think that's what's going to happen. But my question is, do you think this would have happened 5 years ago? You think HBO would have capitulated and pulled it down?
5 years ago?
2 years ago.
Probably not. I think they would have considered it and definitely would have had a conversation with them. And because it's not like Dave got all this attention and power 2 years ago. He's been, you know, in terms of being America's sweetheart, if you will, you know what I mean? And being an outspoken voice, you know what I mean? For Black Lives Matter and all that he speaks about in his comedy. He's been doing that over the years. So 2 years ago, 5 years ago, he has said it. I think they would have backed down.
I think it's, honestly, I think it's less about Dave's power, his visibility, and I think it's more, I think it's a maybe not 50-50, but it's a mix of cancel culture and Black Lives Matter. And I think just the volume of him and the allegation of I'm being taken advantage of and you're complicit has made them say, it's just not worth the money to get any kind of backlash from the community, from that community.
Right.
I think if we weren't where we were in the world, they would have just let him scream and yell, and they would have left that shit up on the platform and let it continue to roll. And honestly, I'm basing a whole lot on conjectures, right? There's no facts, but it's that emotional. When she slipped that emotional in there, I was like, see, you weren't trying to do the right thing. You were trying to avoid backlash, yeah. Which is bullshit to me.
Yeah.
Like it's the, you stumbled on the right thing, right? The intentions, your intentions matter, but you know, good for him that, right. You know, people aren't profiting off of his hard work, his genius, because Chappelle's show was nothing short of genius. And hopefully, you know, maybe Viacom will sit down and talk to him and we can get a Chappelle show, you know, return. I don't know.
I mean, you do what Bill Cosby did. Just call it the Dave Chappelle Show.
Fair enough. That's right.
You know, Cosby did so. I mean, every show he did, he put his name in it, with the exception of Fat Albert. But it was Cosby, the Cosby Show. The Cosby Show was the most famous one. But then Cosby, after that, on CBS, right?
Yeah, I think he played. It was him. Same him and
Felicia Rashad.
Felicia Rashad, and they mm-hmm. were broke. They were like broke people or some shit. But not the same characters. They didn't reprise their roles, just different characters. Right. And now, do you remember the Cosby Mysteries?
Vaguely, but yeah.
Some things shouldn't be tried. I'm just
saying. Listen, you know, so. But, so I had a conversation with my wife this morning.
Okay.
Surrounding our brother, T.I.P., Tip. He's getting some attention again for talking about his daughter.
Again.
Now, I'm just gonna play the audio. I'm just gonna play the audio. And I wanna get your reaction for it. And because my wife, she was particularly for some reason disturbed and irked by what he said, his tone, a bunch of that, but just listen to what he said.
Duval called it thot prevention hours. You got to put in them thot prevention hours. Keep your daughter off the pole. You know what I'm saying? So you spending time going to daddy-daughter dances and you taking them on trips with just you and her. Those are thot prevention hours that you're putting in. You got to do that. You don't do that, but you're going to be somewhere in Magic City, man. You know what I'm saying? Trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
So that is absolutely necessary for any father if you ain't put.
Yeah. Thot prevention hours. What say you? You have a daughter. What do you say?
I do have a daughter. All right. So from a 30,000 foot view, I agree with him. Mm-hmm. From a bit more of an intellectual look at it. Based on my field research over the past 32-ish years of dealing with women in a romantic sense.
Okay.
A whole lot of major issues can be directly tied to the absence of a father, whether that is physically absent, emotionally absent, physically present, but distant. Mm-hmm. However you want to paint that picture, however you want to sign it up. Because I definitely don't want to paint the brush and say every child growing up in a home without the father in is going to turn out to be a stripper, because that's not true, right? And we're not the all and every police, but. No daddy, right? It's when, and I can't remember, I wish I could remember the research right now, but it's a significant percentage of children who don't go to college, who wind up making less money just in a career sense. All of these negative things can be attributed back to a father not being in a home, right? And obviously I have personal experience with it. And you know, I look at the my daughter's future and I'm saving money for therapy, right?
Right,
right. Because I'm not there and I know, yes, right, it's going to be some therapy that's necessary. So I agree with him from a 30,000 foot view, but honestly, I think it's mostly the messenger.
Yeah, okay.
I think I just don't want to agree with him because it's him.
I think that my wife had the same issue. But what she said was, there's strippers that, you know, that had fathers and this and that. You can't, you know, just because you're a stripper don't mean they had a father in the home, and this and that. And okay, granted that there's truth to that, but like, you know, there's research. And it's not just about, okay, so it's more than likely, talking with strippers, and I've had some conversations with some strippers. I actually know one personally. I know her father. I knew that, you know what I'm saying? That I knew her before she was a stripper, and she became a stripper. And I was there to go, why are you doing this? You know what I mean? And in talking with her, she expressed some, what's the word? Resentment for her father. You know what I mean? That, you know, she wasn't raised in the household with him, you know, they have a relationship, had a relationship or whatever, but it wasn't what it came to be with his wife and his wife and kids.
Yep.
You get what I'm saying? And so there was some, and so while she never said this is why, I figured it out pretty clearly. The dynamic between her and there was other factors as well, but she was looking for something from this, you know what I mean? And so that's what I was saying to my wife earlier. Is like, you know, not with daughters, with sons as well. When you're not getting what you need from home, you subconsciously look for it elsewhere. Outside of, you know what I mean? With boys, it could be gangs, you know what I'm saying? Gang life and all those different things, and feeling having a family unit outside of the house. Like, you know what I mean? With girls, it could lead to stripping and seeking attention from some, you know what I mean?
So, validation.
Exactly.
All of it at the end of the day is validation. Whether it's her on the pole, enjoying the fact that she can manipulate men and get a bunch of attention and get money from it, or it's him on the street trying to figure out what masculinity is with a gang, all of it's validation. All of it's validation, seeking masculine validation.
Right.
So getting it from your mom is just not going to be enough. It's great. It's good. But that other part is important.
Yeah. And it's not 100%, you know, Either way, you know what I'm saying? There are other factors, there are other variants that, you know, that contribute to someone's decision to do either or. But it can be traced back to the home.
Straight up daddy issues.
Straight up. And he credited, who is it, Lil Duval for calling it Thot Hours. That whole concept was taken from Chris Rock.
Sometimes I'm walking with my daughter, talking to my daughter, I'm looking at her, I'm pushing and stroller, and sometimes I pick up and I just stare at her, and I realize my only job in life is to keep her off the pole. Keep my baby off the pole. I mean, they don't grade fathers, but if your daughter's a stripper, you fucked up. Yeah, you went mighty wrong there, baby. You thought you had a household. No, you got a whole camp.
Yeah.
Not a whole camp.
Whole camp.
Do I worry about that? I think when my daughter was first born, You bet your ass I was terrified. I was terrified. She gets older, I worry about it less because she's such a creative. So I see her investing her time, and I invest a lot of money into nurturing that part. So I don't think she's going to have enough daddy issues to go and seek validation. And I hope, knock on some wood, that investing in skills and talent will create financial options for her where that is never a consideration. So right. I'm trying to do everything I can, but at a certain point, and you have grown children and you know this, at a certain point, they become grown people and they can do whatever it is they want to do. And there's nothing you can do about it, really.
Very true. Very true. But I know it's what for T.I. It's just, it's the messenger is not what you say, it's how you say it. And yeah, it's kind of.
Yeah. I can't, before I go down this path, what did you think about when he came out and said he would go to the gynecologist visit with his daughter and check on her virginity?
It was weird. It was out of bounds. And you know what I'm saying? It not just for embarrassing his daughter, even if that's, if that's what he's doing. And he later tried to clear it up and said, no, that's not exactly what it, but it's out of bounds. That's out of,
It's way out of bounds. Yeah. It's wildly inappropriate. I get where he's coming from, right? I get the father's fear, but your daughter, she's a teenager, right? Like you wouldn't go in the bathroom while she's taking a shower.
Right.
Why are you going to go with her to the gynecologist?
And for the same, you wouldn't do that for your sons. You know what I'm saying? You wouldn't, it's out of bounds. It was very weird. And he had to backpedal a whole lot because of that. And so coming out with this just reminds people of.
Right. And that's why I have a problem with the messenger on this particular thing, right? So you, based on the story you tell and your own admission of how you go about protecting your daughter's innocence, we'll just say that.
Yeah.
It tells more about your relationship with her and how she trusts you and how you trust her. So you got real big issues in your crib. Now you're talking about spending daddy-daughter time is going to keep her off the pole. Well, you spent a lot of daddy-daughter time, but you following her to the gynecologist to check her virginity. So your daddy-daughter time ain't working, right? So I hear him. I do. I think it's some truth in what he says, but I have a hard time hearing it come from him.
Yeah. It's weird. That's all. Weirdly said. That's all. You know what I mean?
But, goddamn. God bless the brother. That's right. All I can say.
The daughter he was talking about falling to the gynecologist, the doctor. she at the time she unfollowed him on all social medias and was not talking to him. Whatever. He may have that type of backlash again. Why is his wife not going, hey man, will you, maybe she's doing it behind the scenes or.
I think she did come out and say something about it. Nope.
Oh my God. Lord have mercy.
I will put on my tap dance shoes and say it anyway.
Okay. Oh.
If you want for your children to be the best people they can be, then you have to be the best person you can be. They learn by example and not by you dictating.
True.
And I will let everybody read between the lines to figure out what I'm really saying on that. Because I don't want to offend nobody, especially, right. You know, she my homegirl. Yeah. She from the hood and the same alma mater. So,
yeah. I know we're not doing birthdays, but Regina Hall hit a milestone last week, and sing a little song about it.
Like to hear it? Here you go.
Bitch is old today. I passed half my life expectancy. A bitch is old today. But I've been told I still got good pussy. So shout out to all my old bitches. And shout out to all my young bitches. Shout out to all my pretty bitches. And shout out to all my not so pretty bitches. A bitch is old today. And I'm shouting ooh ha hooray. A bitch is old today. But I made it here gratefully.
God bless Regina Hall. You have to see the video of her jumping on the trampoline. And
I am pleased to know that at 50, she still has good pussy.
Yeah. Not that either one of us will ever find out for sure, but listen, have that confidence and say it. Hey, please. Thank you for putting that out. Thank you.
She absolutely does not look 50 years old.
Oh, no.
Not even close to 50 years old. And so I think it was last week we were talking about, it was either last week or the week before, I can't remember. We were talking about women and preferences, and I was saying I usually don't like the super, super beautiful, like, you know, over the top makeup type chick.
Yeah.
And as I was watching that video and I was thinking, I was like, that's the type of chick I like. The Regina Hall type of chick. She's really pretty. She's really cute, but she's not overly done. She's just pretty. She's a pretty girl. It's, you know, not all of the fake hair and the eyelashes and, you know, all of that shit. She wake up pretty. She just wake up pretty.
That I woke up like this. Now, I think what makes her even more beautiful and even sexier is her sense of humor. She's funny.
Yes.
So when she was hosting something, and she did a video, this earlier during the pandemic, she did this video with Kevin Hart. Are you familiar when?
I have not seen it.
She gets on camera, she's like, she wasn't ready or whatever. And Kevin Hart looks, is like, oh my God. She's like not done. And Harris like, he's like, oh yeah, yeah, you good. And he turns and says something to her, like, oh my God, yo, you got to see this. It's terrible. She goes, I can hear you. Like, I'll put a link up for folks to see it. You know, if you hadn't seen it or if you can't remember it. But she's hilarious. I watched that clip dozens of times because it just made me laugh out loud every time. Suppose, especially right now, you kind of need to break away and laugh at shit.
Her role in the Romney Malco movie was funny.
Oh,
she played the correctional officer. Not correctional officer. What is it when you're on parole?
Probation officer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Her description of it. Hood bitch is what she said. Romney said to him, "I want to play a hood bitch. Let me play. I want to play a hood bitch." And so she's a hood bitch in that film. And if you haven't seen the movie, Tijuana Jackson, I forget
Purpose
the full
Over
title.
Prison. Tijuana Jackson, Purpose Over Prison.
Tijuana Jackson and Regina Hall's character, she's a correction officer or probation officer, know each other from childhood. They came up basically the same. He went to prison. She became a cop, but they still cool. So their actions, they kind of counter each other, but they're like almost basically the same person.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? She just never went to prison.
So yeah, I like her. She doesn't take herself too seriously, obviously, by that song and that video. Happy birthday. Whatever you doing, please do a manual and pass it out to all 48 to 49 year old women. Maybe roll back to 45, give them some time, you know, so see, they can get on the page.
Roll it back
you
to 29 going to 30, because some of these sisters got city miles, brother. You got to slow it down a little bit. You know what I mean?
Shit. Hey. You didn't say city miles.
You got the city miles, you know?
Oh, my God. It's a little... Rode hard and put away wet?
Yeah, man. Like, hey.
City miles. That's fucking awesome.
maybe not drink most of the Hennessy. You know what I mean? Just... I can appreciate a woman that drink Hennessy. Yeah, cool. I saw something that's really funny because we got a lot of snow this week. Shout out to DJ Touchstone in Philly. He pulled a post up. If she can drink Hennessy, she can shovel her own snow. She's strong enough to shovel her own snow.
Oh, shit. It's funny because it's true.
Oh, my God. If that sister can drink, if she can drink Hennessy, she's strong enough to shovel her own snow. So,
Equal rights extend to the right to shovel your own goddamn snow. I'm not mad at that. Your hands ain't broke.
Right. Oh, man. My son has been, it's week of, for us, it's the week of Christmas. If you're watching this now, you might be right after, before Christmas, or, you know, ho, ho, ho.
That's actually not what he's saying. That's what I want for Christmas.
He want hoes. three of them, exactly. That's a menage a trois. Anyway, I'm getting all in my head about this. My mom's teaching my 4-year-old the song White Christmas. Cute song. the version by the Delphonics or the Dells, or I forget the name, the most famous version, black version of White Christmas.
Yeah.
Beautiful song. And he's learning the song and singing it, and you know. I understand it's about snow. On Christmas Day, I get it. I'm not that super woke, you know. But there is a part of me that goes, white Christmas?
Why Christmas gotta be white?
Why gotta be white? White Christmas? Really? And so we took family photos this past week out in front of the house. We have a flag on the front door, Black Lives Matter. With a reef over it. The flag stays on the door all the way around, all year round. We put a reef over top of it, you know, and we took some very nice family photos out in front of the house, whatever. And I took one of my three sons, posted it up, and I called it a Black Christmas. You know what I mean? I guess I have a little issue with it. Like, again, like I said, I understand it's about snow, but it's that double entendre on the flip side of it that, you know, you hear folks say, kind of feel like, you know, they mean something else behind it. It's not just snow they talking about. You know what I mean? Especially understanding the history of this nation, and that everything white is good. Everything black is bad. You know, bad guys wear black. You know, Black Friday, you have a black soul. You know what I'm saying? All these different sayings and terminologies associated with black being negative. If you say Black Christmas, it sounds like, you know, it should be a... Matter of fact, wasn't there a movie called that? Black Christmas or something like that? And it was like a horror film or something?
I don't know. Oh, God. I'm about to expose myself here. I'm a bit of a Scrooge. And I've been a bit of a Scrooge for a long time, since I was a kid. So I generally, Christmas movies, like, I think Die Hard is the best Christmas movie ever made, followed by Gremlins, right? Like, I'm not... Miracle on 34th Street, whatever.
Yeah.
So I'm not super into it. I do get the symbolism of white Christmas, you know, obviously it's about snow, but that whole thing. I fell into this rabbit hole probably about 3 years ago. And then I went back down it 2 weeks ago with an old girl who's not from the States. She's not from the US. She's from Europe. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I asked her, because she was talking about Santa Claus and trees and all this shit. And I said, do you know about the racist part of the Santa Claus mythos, especially as it is associated with Europe? She's like, what the fuck are you talking about? So I'm not going to do the whole thing here because I wasn't prepared to do this whole thing.
Okay.
But okay. There's a character, Black Peter.
Okay.
Zwarte Piet, P-I-E-T. Mm-hmm. Google those names. It is a helper, Santa's helper. He's okay. Usually depicted in blackface.
Okay.
And it is, that character is causing quite a stir over in, I want to say, in some of the Scandinavian countries, because it's goddamn racist. And there's a group of people who are like, stop with this shit. And then there's a group of people who are like, it's history, you know, keep it. Same thing in the States. So if you think it's better over there, it's the same shit everywhere you go in the world. It's just, you know, slightly different. But there's some racial overtones and undertones in it. It's been argued that the character is in blackface because that's the character that goes up and down the chimneys, and the blackface is supposed to represent the soot on his face. But it gets really deep. Again, Black Peter, Krampus, you can look up Krampus and all that stuff. Saint Nick, you can just Google Saint Nick and really just kind of dig into it. It's interesting reading. It will ruin your Christmas. and it'll kind of, you know,
that's what we're going for here. We want to ruin Christmas for you. No, I'm just kidding.
We are trying to shit on your Christmas.
Black Christmas, by the way, yes, it was a movie, came out in 2019. It was a horror film. It got 38% on Rotten Tomatoes, so that means it not only was Black Christmas a horror film, it was a shitty movie.
Starring Mike Epps. I'm kidding. I don't know. I'm kidding.
I'm leaving alone.
These are just jokes.
My thing, here's what I'd like to do. And for those who are listening, and then, you know, for those who are of brown or black or, you know, even tan, post pictures up of your family when you take pictures. Hashtag a Black Christmas. Let's take the negative connotation off the word black and Black Christmas and just hashtag Black Christmas. You know what I mean? Let's put a positive image, you know what I'm saying, out in the ethos. And, you know, let's see if it takes off. It just feels so one-sided. Again, snow, yeah, sure. We don't want to see black snow. But we like black sand. You know what I mean? So, hey, you know, that's my power to the people soapbox.
This power to the people moment brought to you by T-Storm.
Well, that works.
Speaking of blackness and power to the people, photos from the set of Coming to America have been released. Yeah. It's kind of looking good.
Yeah, that's that Teyana Taylor. She, her physique is awesome. I think, did she have the baby before or at, was it before this picture or after? Whichever it is.
Dude, I don't know. That sister's
in great shape.
I had a dream like that once. Strong features in the,
say again?
I had a dream like that once.
I'm trying not to objectify the sister. I'm just complimenting her physique. And if she, if, well, no, this was before she, I think they shot this. She just had the baby just more recently. So no, this is before. Okay. That answers my question. Cause I'm like, if you, she snapped back like that, golly.
Good Lord.
But yeah, it's funny to see, Wesley Snipes with a, that painted on beard.
So Wesley is in the remake, the sequel to the popular Eddie Murphy Arsenio Hall film Coming to America that came out forever ago. He did a an interview with E Weekly. He revealed that he tried out for the first one, didn't get the role, yada yada yada. So yeah, I just thought it would be cool to look at some of the pictures from the set. Your girl Leslie,
Big Les. Leslie Jones. Oh, that's the I forget the brother's name. That's saying, "She's your queen to be."
That's him.
Like he, I don't know what other movies. I'm not familiar with other movies that brother did afterwards. But he was. I think. I don't know for sure, but I believe he kind of did he freestyle that song.
Oh, I don't know, but that would have been awesome if he did.
Oh man, here's another question. So the score of the original Coming to America was done by Nile Rodgers.
Okay.
Every piece of music in the movie Coming to America was done by Nile Rodgers, down to the Jerry Curl song. Soul Glow.
Let your soul...
I can't hit the note. But that was... Now Rodgers did that. I wonder if he had anything to do with this film. Would they, you know what I mean?
That's a good question. I'll have to get my research on.
It would be awesome if he did. It would be awesome if he did.
Arsenio and Tracy Morgan. Arsenio is coming back for the movie. That's great.
Yeah.
Who else we got here? Eddie and that ugly ass jacket. With all of that shit screams tourist.
with all the buttons on it. I love New York, New York, New York. Oh man, I frequently call McDonald's McDowell's, and my 4-year-old corrects me every time. He doesn't get the joke. I have to figure a way how to have let him see the movie without ruining his childhood. I don't know if it's 4-year-old appropriate yet.
Oh God, no, it's not. Not for 4-year-old. Yeah. Maybe 7 or 8, but not 4.
Yeah. For you, but he gets like his humor, his concept and understanding of humor is on point. So, I can't wait to see it. Me too, man.
Of all of the movies that I wanted them to make a sequel to, it was that one. And I'm happy they're finally doing it. It took forever, but that original film was. I remember. You know what that was? That was Wakanda before Wakanda.
Oh, absolutely.
That was Wakanda before Wakanda. I remember being a kid seeing that, like, wow, look at these, you know, rich black folk from Africa, you know, with the whoever did wardrobe and set design for that shit, hats off to them. Cause it was, you know, the tuxedo with the lion pelt, you know. I was like, yeah, that shit was dope. It was dope. But that was in my opinion, one of his best films.
Yeah. And I'm glad that James Earl Jones is still around. You know?
Yeah, man.
So, it'll be a good time. So this movie's been done forever. Like they did it. They were shooting the same time as Bad Boys 3.
Oh, word? Yeah.
Yeah, there was a, they were on the soundstage together. There's pictures that with Will Smith when they went back for reshoots and caught up. There's a video with Will and Martin with Eddie and you know I want to say Tracy Morgan was in the video as well, maybe, or I forget. But in any case, from back then, so that's like almost 2 years ago at this point.
Damn.
A film has been done. They shot it in Atlanta on Tyler Perry's soundstage.
I remember when they were shooting Bad Boys 3 because they were blocking off roads to do car scenes. I was like, look, y'all shoot at night because y'all keep me from getting to the job. I need to get to work. But yeah, man, I'm excited for it, bro. I am.
Speaking of Tyler Perry, you had a particularly feel-good story from Tyler Perry?
Yes, a feel-good story, and I also had to do a little bit of research on this. So Tyler Perry donated $100,000 to the legal defense fund of, what is this guy's name? Kenneth Walker. Now, Kenneth Walker is Breonna Taylor's boyfriend who was in the house with her the night that the cops executed the no-knock warrant, kicked the door in, and ultimately that ended in her life, ended her life. Now, when that happened, the officers came through the door. One side is saying they didn't announce themselves. The other side is saying they did. But going with Mr. Walker's narrative, they came in the door. He didn't know who the hell was coming in the house. He is a legal licensed gun owner. He popped off a shot. It hit Officer Jonathan Mattingly, I think that's the correct first name for him, in the leg near his femoral artery, which, you know, if you don't get that taken care of, you will fucking bleed out and die. So.
He returned fire, which, and I believe I understand, the bullets from his gun is what ultimately killed Breonna Taylor.
Yes. The city was still going after Kenneth Walker for firing his weapon, whatever. And they wised up and said, let's just let that go. Kenneth Walker filed suit against the city. And I think the officers. Mr. Mattingly filed a countersuit, amongst other things, claiming emotional distress.
Okay.
Emotional distress and trauma. And it was some other charges. I don't remember what they were. I just found that one to be the most ridiculous. Because you're a police officer executing a no-knock warrant and you got shot at and you're like emotional distress. I can imagine that your entire job is emotionally distressing. So we've got to weigh some stuff
here. Killed somebody. You killed somebody. How about the emotional distress from you? You know, that is
not even in a comparison method, just on some what you know about your job and assumed risk. Right? Because I'm not trying to compare. I don't want to compare because that's when I get into trouble. Probably I'm already in trouble, but whatever. So Mr. Mattingly files a countersuit again amongst all of the claims, one of them being emotional distress. So now this gentleman who suffered the loss of his girlfriend is living through the subsequent slow process of inquiry and justice and having to fight charges of discharging his firearm, now has to deal with this. So a GoFundMe was started, and the goal was to get to $100,000. And it wasn't hitting. It wasn't getting there. It was like under 10, like around 9 and some change.
Okay.
Mr. Tyler Perry came through, dropped 10 grand. Then and I don't know if this was his actual thinking, but he dropped 10 grand and then he was like, man, that ain't enough. And he dropped 50 grand. And then he dropped another 30. So that's 90. So he must have put some more in there because they reported at 100.
But so he gave, you know, yeah.
At the end of the day, dude came out of pocket $100,000 for somebody he does not know.
You know, say what you want. The brother has been stepping up and being the community's guardian angel. Earlier this year, there was a brother that had got sick across, where was he, in Mexico somewhere? He got sick and he didn't have health insurance in that country or whatever. I don't think he had health insurance at all. And they wouldn't let him leave the hospital. Like, they had locked him, basically, because he couldn't afford to pay, they basically boxed him in the hospital. And his girlfriend that was there had, you know, reached out, and it got on news media and whatever, and Tyler Perry paid his bill, his medical bill, and helped him get home. I think I believe that brother was from Atlanta as well.
Okay.
He's constantly doing, you know, stuff like this. That's a brother that's, you know, definitely using his wealth for good. And it's good to see. It's good to see. I mean, I'm sure there's tons of other things that he's doing that we don't hear about. You know what I'm saying? Because he seems like that kind of cat.
He is.
You know?
He is. And in another capacity, I've had leave to reach out to him and ask him for some assistance, but not for myself, wow, but for some families in need. Look, yeah, anybody who knows me knows how I feel, right? So people watching, maybe this will be a shock to you, maybe it won't. I'm not a fan of his work.
No.
I'm not.
Really? Come on, stop. Yo, I can't believe you would say something like that. I mean, you think Boo 1 and 2 weren't Madea's, Boo 1 and 2 wasn't like Oscar worthy materials? Come on, son.
Nope, I'm not.
What was the film he did earlier this year? He put out, you know, and not long after that, he had a video talking about how he doesn't have a writer's room. He writes all of his films and TV shows himself. And he was like, you know, it's what keeps me going. This is work ethic. And he showed all the scripts and everything that he wrote. He writes himself. Like, he doesn't have a writer. At the time, he didn't have a writer's room. You don't, you know.
Oh, yeah. God.
This is called torture.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another edition of Ooh, This Is Where Black People Gonna Hate Me.
Okay, here we go.
Look, I'm not a huge fan of his work because I don't see myself in his work. And I am a fan of other things where I don't see myself in, but those things aren't created to be a representation of me, right? His stuff is like, that's his purpose and his goal. And he wanted to do some stuff where people could see themselves, our people could see themselves. And I can't see myself in it. Now, make the content because it appeals to different people who need it. He puts good stuff in it, right? He puts messages and moral direction and ethics. For the most part, he puts that in there, and some people need that. Some people ain't getting it from nowhere else but from there, and it makes a difference. And he, like you said, he takes his money and he puts it back into the community that he's taking money out of, right? All of that's great. I just don't particularly love the content. To the point of him not having a writer's room, I don't think that's a good thing. Like, some people will point to that and say, oh, he's so creative, he can do it. But I don't think that's a good thing. Because as a creative, it took me a long time to realize I cannot know and do it all myself. And when I started working with other people, I can edit, I can design, I can record, I can rap, I can do all of that shit. But I'm not the best at all of that shit. So when it's time to get something done, I create a vision. And then I bring other people in to help execute the vision. right?
Yeah. And not just that. I mean, if it's just you writing it, again, there are some Tyler Perry movies and projects and shows that I've watched and enjoyed. Most, I'm just kind of like, you know, and this is a, this is an, a discussion slash argument I have with my wife frequently about Tyler Perry. Because some, you know, I think some of it, like some of it, I don't see me in it, which is fine. But some of it, I just think is, it's way, some of the characters are way off base and kind of embarrassing to me.
It's a caricature of black people, which
right.
I find to be mildly offensive.
And I get, I mean, I get it is a double standard. Like, Caucasian film actors and directors can make movies that will be buffoonery and whatever case, and just silly, and people won't think anything of it. Will Ferrell, and you know the movies they are extremely, you know what I'm saying?
I'm not a huge fan of Will Ferrell.
I like Will Ferrell sometimes, but you know some of the movies. Like, what was it? Brothers? What was it called? The Brothers?
Him and the other guy. Yeah, no. I know what you're talking about.
I forget the name of the film off the top of my head. But in any case, you know, there are certain parts of that movie that I find pretty funny, but for the most part, it's just too stupid for me, some of it, right? And nobody says anything about it, though. That's the thing. But when black folks do it, oh, you're buffooning, you're, you know what I'm saying, You're being a buffoon. You're cooning for the, you know. So I get the double standard, and you know, unfortunately, that double standard is real, and we have to pay attention to it because of the history, our history, in this country,
and our history in Hollywood. The buffoon right. character, we were regulated to the buffoon character. We were right. regulated to the servant character, right? So when we make that character and we make it a caricature of that character, it's over the top. I find it mildly offensive. Now, I am able to separate how I feel about it and what it actually is and deal with it intellectually and say, look, I just because I don't like it, I wouldn't say that it should never be made. Make it. That's fine. It's right. just not for me. It's for a whole lot of other people. Just not for me.
Those folks, yeah. Right. So, I applaud him. I applaud the stuff, you know, what he's accomplished, where he came from. I think it's absolutely one. This brother bought a Confederate army base and turned it into a, like, come on, son. Like, that's vindication on so many different levels, and it's wonderful to see. It's encouraging. It is a powerful statement letting you know it's possible. Your dreams can come true. If you only wear a dress. No, I'm kidding. But
you know, I actually saw an interview with him mm-hmm. that made me, I like him as an individual, don't like his content, but I saw an interview with him that made me like him as an individual even more. He was, because I don't like men in dresses. I just don't. I didn't like Tu Wong Fu. I enjoyed Mrs. Doubtfire, but I felt some kind of way about goddamn Mrs. Doubtfire too. So it ain't just no black shit. Yeah. But he did an interview where he was like, man, I don't like that shit. I don't like putting on that dress. I don't want to do that no more. he said, I did what I had to do. And that character right. became a beloved character. So like, how can I stop doing it? But he's like, and I'm paraphrasing, but he was like, yeah, I don't particularly enjoy doing that shit. And I was like, I mean, okay, we might that's be more said. On the same page than I thought we were.
That's what he said. But he keep doing it. So I'm just saying, you know.
You don't need the money at this point, bruh.
At this point, it becomes as a choice. That's because folks say, hey, you should put some shit on your head. We like to see you with some shit on your head. We really love to see you with some shit on your head. Would you do it? No. I'm cool. I'm cool.
But no, hats off to
him. I can imagine it.
For all of the shit that he's accomplished, man. You know, he's done great things.
With all that said, he put up this image.
I can't see it. Oh, here we go. mm-hmm.
His version of a thirst trap. Brother's in good shape. This is the caption says, this is what midlife, this is what a midlife crisis looks like. I'm a 51 single and wondering what the next chapter in my life will look like. Whatever it looks like, I'm going to walk with God, be the best father and man I can be, hold my head up high, and try to look my best doing it. In a world with so much sadness, please try and stay in the good. Merry Christmas, and let's look forward to 2021 bringing us peace. First thing people noticed out of that, we know he had a child. I believe he was engaged, and now he's single. Interesting. Didn't hear about the breakup. Didn't hear nothing. I mean, not that we would or we had to. It's just kind of interesting. I just
wanted everybody to really see the picture.
Yeah.
You know.
Brother Christian, listen, and we're about the same height. He's about 6'4", 6'5". So, again, that gives me hope. Like, I look to him and Busta Rhymes.
Look.
Go, okay, I could do it.
Look, he is in good shape. That is certainly a thirst trap. I'm gonna leave that there. But in turn, look, the kind of time and money that he has to put towards that, they ain't like the time and money we got.
This is true. Fine. I was gonna say, you know, I maybe they got tired of wearing the same wardrobe. I don't know.
I'm trying.
He didn't want her wearing his Madea dresses no more. I'm joking. I'm kidding.
Oh boy. Boy.
Well, how is it, you know, so he got a kid. So obviously him and the young lady had been intimate.
Did she hear the Madea voice? Michael Jackson had a couple kids.
Oh, this is true. I was going to say, what if the Madea voice slipped out in the bedroom?
Oh, I hope not. Oh my God. I could just see her getting up going, nope. Nope.
On a child. Whoa. Wait a minute.
Don't mind me, baby. I'm just going to put this wig on and this girdle and these shoes. It ain't nothing. Don't worry about it.
I, you know what? I might as well put the saggy titties on right now too. Okay, just hang on. Just give me a second.
Just go with it, baby. Be in the moment.
Sister said, "I'm out. I can't do this. I'm gonna exit." Who knows? Just jokes, folks.
Genuine respect to the brother. The rest is jokes.
Serious Tyler Perry fans going, God, that's blasphemy. No.
Look, everybody can get these jokes. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Everybody get these jokes.
God damn it. You know what I mean? So, yes, yeah, that sister was like, I don't want to Madea's dress.
Who was his fiance?
I don't know. Ghost woman. I think I saw images of her somewhere, sometime, some point. But
Jaleela Beckel.
It was just her. Okay, he got a kid now.
Oh, she's a cutie pie.
They were engaged. I was like, oh, okay, cool. You know,
she's a cutie pie. Aw. I just got sad. Why did it fucking make me sad? I have some ideas, but I'm not.
I'm trying to be good. Since we're close to wrapping up. I'm trying to keep from. She's gorgeous. Or maybe maybe the contract ran out. I don't know.
Oh. She didn't get renewed for season two.
All right. Thank you. This has been fun. I'm seeking other opportunities. And
oh shit.
We'll see. The Bachelor has an opening. You know.
Not get renewed for season two. Mm-hmm. There will be no sequel. Mm-mm. Oh my God, that's funny.
On that note, folks. Hey, man. We appreciate y'all listening. We appreciate y'all watching. If you're following us, make sure you follow us on all socials at Unpopin Show. Of course, our website, unpopinshow.com. See all you missed. I'm kind of hesitant. There's a new social media thing that I'm messing with. I don't want to mention it here because I don't want to publicize it for free. Or at least not on the main show. I'll talk about it on the after show. But folks, thanks again. We appreciate everyone. We appreciate you, you know, hanging with us since the summer.
Yeah.
we started doing this 2020. Hoping that 2021 is not just plus one. 2020 plus one. That is a better year. And you know, better days ahead. Because 2020, you know, in the grand scheme of things, 2020 was kind of shitty. I think we can all agree to that. There were great things that came out of it.
Have you, random thought, but I know we're closing. Have you seen mm-hmm. the Match.com commercials where the devil is dating 2020? Oh my God. It's the best bit of marketing I have seen in a very long time. The devil matches with 2020 on the app and they go on these dates. And it was like one of the commercials, they're sitting and they're like, the devil says, I don't want this year to end. And she goes, well, who would? it's brilliant. If you haven't seen those commercials, I'll try. If I find them, I'll link them below. If for everybody on YouTube, if you're listening, please go and find them. Absolutely great. This is not an endorsement of Match. They did not pay me for this. I like to call out creativity when I see it.
Word. Okay. Yeah, I have to check that one out, man. Yo, it's been fun. Have a Merry Christmas, Happy Kwanzaa, Happy Hanukkah, or Chanukah, as Smokey Robinson said. And Happy New Year. We'll see you in 2021.
Peace.
Hey, thanks for watching the Unpopular Opinion Show right here on YouTube. Appreciate you watching. If you enjoyed what you watched, be sure to subscribe, like, and hit that notification button.
Yeah, hit it. Well, you haven't hit it yet.
You ain't hit it yet. What do you? God, come on, now, people.
Okay, the like button too. I mean, you got it.
Yes, got it. All right, cool. Thank you. Appreciate you.